Connect your scan tool to the vehicle's DCL connector, and when you're doing scan data analysis, do not guess at specifications. Look up vehicle-specific specification. I can't emphasize this enough. Turn the key on, engine off, set your scan tool up to read the data. Compare each data bit to specifications, and then use some common sense. Engine RPM should be zero if the engine is running key on, engine off. If it isn't zero, go to PCM testing. TPS should be within specifications. If the TPS isn't within specifications, test the TPS and its circuits. Cold oxygen sensors should show close to reference voltage. If the oxygen sensors don't show the reference or close to reference, test the sensors to see if they are shorted or not. If they are not shorted, go to PCM testing. Heated oxygen sensors will decrease voltage as they heat up with the ignition turned on. Hot oxygen sensors, after you've had the key on for a while, will not read 0.45 volts. For an analysis of long-term fuel trim, go to fuel injection first test. And don't overlook this. Make sure you know how to read adaptive fuel factors. Map sensor should be within specification. If it isn't, test the map and its circuits. Engine temperature should match actual engine temperature. If the ECT and the inlet air temperature should match within 10 degrees after the engine has been off for several hours. You're going to turn the key off, let it sit for 5 hours, and you're going to plug it back in and look at the ECT and IET. You know, a better habit to get into is carry your scan tool out to the vehicle before you pull it into your shop, plug your scan tool in, and then compare ECT and IET out in the parking lot. It's a good indication to see if they're working normally or not. A more accurate test, of course, is to compare the ECT scan data to actual engine temperature. And you see we got our Raytec gun out there, and we're going to measure actual engine temperature as close to the thermostat as possible. As close to the ECT sensor as possible. So you get as close to the reading as you can, and they should be within 10% of each other. Now, injector pulse width should be approximately 88 milliseconds on a cool engine. Now, we're calling a cool engine 50 degrees Fahrenheit. If injector pulse width is not within this range, check for a reprogramming TSB, and then, of course, follow those instructions. Now, the IAC will show the amount of bypass air the PCM has set for the engine at startup. This is going to vary with temperature. The example we're showing you here on the screen at 49.5% is on a cool engine, once again near 50 degrees. System voltage should be 12.6 volts, which shows a fully charged battery. If battery voltage is lower than fully charged, you must find out why. It may be as simple as you've been testing with the ignition on for a long period. If you can't determine a reason, go to starting and charging system problems and continue testing there. Now start the engine and let it fully warm up. With the engine running at idle, the data will change to reflect the information. We have stopped the data at one point in time so we can discuss it. On some Chrysler models, the PID for battery voltage may be displayed as control module volts. Now, this is very important because you're down looking for system voltage or battery voltage and you can't find it because your PIDs are in alphabetical order and you're on B's. Of course, you got to be aware that on some of the new models they're called control module volts. Just like key on, engine off, we're going to go through the data and compare it to specifications. RPM must match actual engine speed. If not, go to ignition and fuel control testing. Compare the TPS voltage to specifications. If the voltage is higher than specifications, it is possible that the throttle stop screw has been adjusted by a technician who worked on the car before you. If the TPS voltage is not normal, look at the IAC counts. This is a normal reading on a vehicle that's in closed loop, this 34.8%. If the counts are higher than normal, the PCM is commanding additional bypass air. Now, you want to check for things like power steering pressure switch, the AC switch, the park neutral switch. Why? Because if the computer is commanding more bypass air, it may be getting a signal from one of these switches saying, hey, I put a slight load on the engine, go ahead and change bypass air and bring the idle back up to normal. If it's higher than normal, the IAC, you of course want to check the throttle bore for restrictions. Now look at this dirty throttle bore we have here. A dirty throttle bore or a power steering pressure switch, AC switch, or park neutral switch can cause IAC counts to be higher than normal. Special note here, you know, a dirty, a carboned up throttle bore indicates that the intake manifold and the back of the intake valves are also dirty, along with the fuel rail and the injectors. Only cleaning the throttle bore will not fix the problem. Carbon is going to build up in these fuel rails and on the injector tips as well. It's going to be the same. Looks just like it does in a throttle bore. If the throttle has carbon buildup, your decarbonization process must address the rest of the carbon in the engine. Once you're sure that the throttle bore isn't dirty or the carbon has been removed because you cleaned it, go ahead and continue with the scan data diagnosis. Now, if the counts are lower than normal, the IAC counts are lower than normal, the PCM is commanding less bypass air, and then you'll want to go check for vacuum leaks. Continue comparing the data to specifications. The oxygen sensor should move between 0.1 and 0.9 millivolts. If not, go to pressure and volume, fuel pressure and volume testing. The MAP should be within specifications. If the MAP is higher than normal, you may want to go to engine vacuum testing. It may indicate that it may be reading accurate and you may have low engine vacuum and you want to check that out. If engine vacuum's normal, test the MAP sensor and its circuits. Now, we have special tests on the MAP on the MPC spec disc. If you have your own procedures, fine. If you don't, use the MPC spec disc, the smart disc, and go ahead and it will help you diagnose these sensors. So when we say go test the ECT, go test the TPS, if you have difficulty doing that, go ahead and use the smart disc. Now, if the MAP voltage is lower than normal, test the voltage reference, and you're really going to start testing the MAP and its circuitry. Test the MAP sensor for 5-volt reference. You have to get 5 volts from the PCM to the sensor. If the reference voltage isn't within specifications, you need to go to PCM testing. If reference voltage is within specification, test the MAP and its other two circuits. Now, engine temperature should match actual engine temperature as it did key on engine off. If it doesn't, test the ECT sensor and its circuits. The injector pulse width should match specifications. Now, if it doesn't, you're going to want to go to long-term fuel trim and then analyze that. The injector pulse width may not be within specifications if there's a fuel system problem. So, if the injector pulse width isn't correct, go to fuel pressure and volume testing. Inlet air temperature should match actual air temperature. If it doesn't, once again, test the sensor and its circuits. System voltage should match specifications. And if it doesn't, don't overlook it. Go to starting and charging problems and diagnose that right away. Low system voltage can cause a variety of drivability problems. And you have to make sure that system voltage is normal. Ignition scan data is the same as fuel system data. Set up your scan screen with data that pertains to the ignition system. And another thing is you want to look up some key facts here because you want to know some things about this ignition system. Now, the PCM controls each coil on plug module to fire the cylinder. And that's telling us on this system we have an individual driver for each coil. And then we'll want to look up key facts on a cam and crank sensor. So we need to know key facts about the ignition system, the actual how it works information. After the scan tool screen is set up, do a quick review with the engine off, key on, engine off. Spark advance is going to be about 4 degrees. Now, if it isn't about 4 degrees, go ahead and test the PCM. Cam sync state and cam sync with the engine off should display not sync. If it isn't, go to ignition fuel control test and PCM test. Crank sync state and crank sync with the engine off should be in sync. If it isn't, go to ignition fuel control test and the PCM test. Knock retard should be zero. If it isn't, go to the PCM test. Then watch the same data as the engine is cranked. Engine speed should show engine RPM. If it doesn't, go to ignition fuel control testing and PCM testing. Spark advance should show a small amount of ignition advance, under 20 degrees, definitely under 20 degrees. If it doesn't, go to ignition fuel control testing and PCM testing. Cam sync signal will indicate not sync until the engine is cranked for a few seconds. After that, the state should change to in sync. If not, go to ignition fuel control test. Next, watch the data at warm idle. After the engine starts, you will see spark advance begin to make changes. This indicates that the PCM is controlling timing. All is good. Next, road test the vehicle. Notice that after the vehicle is driven and then you come back to a stop, the spark advance remains higher than normal, or at least higher than it was when the vehicle was at idle a few minutes ago before you took off on the road test. This is normal. What we're saying is, as you drive the vehicle, spark advance is going to advance. It's going to increase. Then when you come back to a stop, don't expect it to drop down immediately. It comes down slowly. If spark advance remains high after several minutes of idle, go to PCM testing. Both cam and crank must stay in sync. If not, go to ignition fuel control testing and PCM test. Study scan data and select a menu item that you want to test next. You will now return to the menu.